Hello, in this presentation we're going to continue talking about geologic time, focusing on absolute age dating. This is one of the two techniques that we use to determine the age of events during Earth's history. As we talked about before, relative age dating gives us the sequence of events, and again it has no distinct age that's determined, but it just tells us the ordering. Absolute age dating does tell us the numerical date of events. It's based on the radioactive decay of isotopes, and the important thing to note is that when we're looking at samples, it tells us when igneous rocks crystallize, when metamorphic rocks were metamorphosed, and when organic material was last alive. So when did it take its last breath? To understand absolute age dating, we do quickly need to go over some chemistry review. So what we're looking at here is a picture of the periodic table, and the reminder is that all of the elements in the periodic table are arranged by their atomic number. That number is listed at the top. The atomic number is the number of protons that are inside of the atom's nucleus. Okay, the mass number, which tells us the weight of the atom, is the mass of the protons plus the mass of the neutrons. And again, these are all the particles inside of the nucleus. Neutrons have no charge. They are formed by the combination of one proton and one electron, so that negates the charge. And again, the only particles that have mass inside of this atom are the protons and the neutrons. So when we add that together, that tells us the weight of that individual atom. All right. Let's see. So an isotope is an atom with a different number of neutrons and the same number of protons. What this does is it gives isotopes a different mass number. And the important thing to note is that not all isotopes are stable, and inactive isotopes decay into more stable isotopes. And so what's actually happening is that the unstable bonds between the protons and the neutrons causes the nucleus to start to spontaneously decay, and it will decay in different ways. One example of an isotope that many people are familiar with is carbon. So what I have listed up here is the three isotopes of carbon. We have carbon 12, carbon 13, and carbon 14. Each of these isotopes has six protons in the nucleus. That's what makes it carbon. The difference is that they have a different number of neutrons inside of their nuclei. So carbon 12 has six protons and six neutrons, carbon 13 has six protons and seven neutrons, and carbon 14 has six protons and eight neutrons. Carbon 12 is stable and very common. Carbon 13 is not a common isotope, while carbon 14 is very unstable, so it has too many of those neutrons, and it's going to undergo a spontaneous decay to become something else. So what's happening with carbon 14? Carbon 14 forms high up in the atmosphere. And what happens is we have high energy particles are shattering the nuclei and releasing neutrons. When you have a nitrogen 14, which we're seeing here, it's going to capture one of these extra neutrons and it's going to bring it into its nucleus, okay? And that actually causes it to change. It becomes carbon 14 because, again, we're adding actually a proton to it, so it's going to change its atomic number, and it's going to then undergo some proton emission, and that's going to change it back. So carbon 14 in the atmosphere, it combines with oxygen to form CO2. All organisms, as we're respirating and we're breathing, we're taking in CO2. And as we take in that CO2, some of those CO2s are going to be combined with C14, and that C14 is constantly being replenished in our bodies while we're alive. Now, once an organism dies, it stops to respirate, so no carbon 14 is going to be added to the body of that organism after it's dead. So the carbon 14 is going to spontaneously decay, and it's that process, the fact that no more is being added, that allows us to use the time of decay to figure out how long ago the organism was once alive. Okay. So radiocarbon dating is used When carbon-14 is used to determine when the organism was last alive, it's used for dating prehistoric events. It has a half-life of 5,730 years, and we can use it to date events back to about 75,000 years ago. Okay, so kind of prehistoric events. Think about when mammoths were last walking. If you can find a mammoth's body and preserve it, then you can actually look at the carbon-14 in it to figure out when it was last alive. Okay, there are different types of decay that are happening in our isotopes that you need to know about. The first that we're looking at here is called alpha emission. This occurs when the unstable isotope atom decays into the stable daughter atom and an alpha particle. Alpha particles are two protons and two neutrons. So that's what we're looking at here, two protons and two neutrons. During alpha emission, the unstable atom ejects the alpha particle to become more stable. So the new daughter atom has a different atomic number, it's two less, and a different mass number. So it has fewer heavy particles inside of it. One example of alpha emission occurs when uranium-238 decays into thorium-234. This decay process is only one step in the ultimate decay of uranium-238 into lead-206. Okay, and so the diagram that we're actually looking at here shows the parent nucleus ejecting out that alpha particle to become the daughter nucleus. Okay, beta emission is the second type of decay process. This occurs when the unstable parent atom ejects a beta particle to become a more stable daughter atom. A beta particle is an electron that came from a neutron within the nucleus. Because electrons have no mass and there is now an additional proton in the nucleus, the daughter atom will have a different atomic number than the unstable parent. One example of beta emission is the decay between strontium-87 and rubidium-87. So what we're looking at in this diagram is the unstable parent. So it's taking one of its neutrons and it's going to say, hey, little electron, beta particle, get out of here. It spits it out. And now that neutron has become a proton. Okay, so we can see that there's just been a change in the element that we have. Okay, and then the last type of decay process that we have is called electron capture. So just remember we have those beta particles floating around. So now if we have our unstable parent atom and it incorporates one of those free electrons, those free beta particles into its nucleus, the electron is going to combine with a proton that's in the nucleus to become a neutron. So that's what we're looking at here. Here's the proton, that free electron, they combine together and it becomes a neutron. The daughter isotope now has one less proton and a different atomic number. One example of electron capture is the decay of potassium-40, whoops, right here, into argon-40. So that's just one example. Now, when we start to look at the decay processes, we often hear the word half-life. Half-life is the time it takes for half of the unstable isotope to decay into the stable isotope. The rate of decay of all isotopes is constant. So what we're looking at here is a graph that shows the unstable atoms decaying over time. So we're looking at the very beginning, we have the sample is contained of 100% of the parent atom. After one half-life, there is 50% of the parent atom left. So we've gone through, this is showing the decay process to one half-life. Now these dots are 50% parent atoms and 50% daughter atoms. If we decay one more half-life, okay, those remaining parent atoms, those 50 atoms that we had before, now only 25 of them are still the parent atom, and we have 75 atoms of the daughter. One more half-life, we're going to take that 25% and we're going to divide it by 2. So now 13% of the parent is left and 87% of the atoms are now the daughter. Okay, so this is going to continue until you start to run out of the parent, until you can no longer decay. Okay, after four half-lives, there are only going to be 6% of the parent left and 94% of the daughter atoms. So the number of the parent atoms is decaying down, getting closer and closer to zero. Okay. Radiometric isotopes that are used to date rocks that we see are shown here. So these are just a couple of examples of things that are used along with their known half-lives. So uranium-238 to lead-206, the half-life for that is about 4.5 billion years. Thorium-232 to lead-208 takes 14.1 billion years. You can see that these are very long time periods. We use different isotopes to age date different types of rocks, and that's because when we're age dating the rocks, we're actually age dating individual mineral grains, and it's important to note that not all minerals contain all of the elements that you see in this listing. So the question is, how can we calculate the age date of a rock? So I have an example here that you go on a trip out to Colorado, you find a sample, you bring it back to the lab, and you find out that it has an isotopic ratio of parent to daughter that is 1 to 15. So one atom of the parent to 15 of the daughter. You know that the half-life of the isotope that you're using is 0.5 million years. So the question is, how old is your rock? To complete this example, I like to make tables, and we can actually walk through to figure out how many half-lives have passed in this sample. So in this example, we're going to start out with 16 parent atoms. I just took 15 and 1, added it together, and we got 16. So at the 0 point, we have 16 parent atoms and 0 daughter atoms. After one half-life, we divide 16 by 2, and we get 8, and then that means 8 have become the daughter atom. After two half-lives, the remaining parent, we divide it by 2 to get 4, and we send 4 over to the daughter side. So after the third half-life, again, divide 4 by 2, and then send 2 over, so 12 plus 2 is 14. And the last one, for the fourth half-life, divide 2 by 1, and that means we send 1 over. So now we're down to the ratio we had before, which is 1 to 15. This tells us that 4 half-lives have passed. We're going to multiply the number of half-lives by the known half-life, which is 0.5 million years, and that tells us that the mineral grains we're looking at were formed 2 million years ago. Okay, now some notes to keep in mind about radiometric age dating. Carbon-14 is used for organic materials only. It does have a very short half-life. So when we're looking at rocks, we're going to use other isotopes to age date our rocks. So like that uranium-238 to lead-206 or rubidium-87 to strontium-87. Okay, these have much longer half-lives and they're useful for things that don't contain carbon. So the picture of our cow here, just remember that as this cow is respirating, it's breathing in a little bit of CO2, and that's adding that C14 to it. Once it dies, then we could actually start to figure out how long ago it had died by looking at that carbon-14 age dating. All right, so what's the big deal? When we're using relative and absolute age dating techniques, we can construct a time scale of the Earth's history. Okay, so here we're looking at one view of the geologic time scale. The history of the Earth is divided into many different time divisions. The longest time divisions are the eons. We then subdivide those into eras, and then those into periods and epochs or epochs. When we look at a scale like this, this one shows it very nicely. We can see all these nice periods kind of divided out. But what's important to note is that the geologic time scales that we often see are not to scale, so we can look at them different ways. All of these periods that we often hear about are time periods where we see lots of fossil records. We can talk a lot about them. But what's really important to note is that the Phanerozoic eon, so things that happened before the Phanerozoic, all of that time period, which is squished way down here, this is 88% of Earth's history. Okay, so a lot of the things that we think about happened actually very recently in Earth's history. Okay, so just going to take a quick closing. So, some things to know: the origin of the Earth is 4.6 billion years old. The Precambrian represents 88% of the Earth's history. The Phanerozoic, which is just the last approximately 550 million years, includes most recently the Cenozoic or Age of Mammals. Before that was the Mesozoic when we had our dinosaurs, the Age of Reptiles, the Paleozoic, which can be further broken down into periods. So, we have had invertebrates first, and then fish, and then amphibians. Okay, there are many extinction events that have happened in Earth's history, and two major ones to know about are the Permian-Triassic extinction about 248 million years ago, and then the extinction of the dinosaurs at the end of the Mesozoic about 65 million years ago. So that's where we're going to end this lecture. I hope you enjoyed learning all about absolute age dating techniques.